Ahoy, everybody! Just want to start off with a big thank you to all those who donated to the channel. Particularly following my last video, The Philosopher's Sandbar. I wasn't exactly sure how that one was going to go down, but you sure came through with your generosity. So I thank you all very much for that.
So the plan was to weigh anchor just after the tide turned. So essentially I'd have a slack current, so then I could raise the mainsail while she was head to wind. But I was kind of slow off the mark, getting the boat prepped for sailing, and as the saying goes, time and tide wait for no man. So now we got to deal with the situation as it is now, which is we have an ebbing current which is holding her basically beamed to the wind.
So the anchor's fouled on the port side of the bobstay. So let's try.
So in case you didn't hear that over the wind noise, the anchor is off on the port side, which means it's going around on the bobstay. And I can't pull the anchor up, especially the chain, when it's angled on the bobstay. It's too difficult, plus it chafes the bobstay, even though I have anti-chafe on there. And so I just pushed the helm over, gave myself hard left rudder to push the bow over to port, and indeed, then I managed to get the anchor on the starboard side and clear the bobstay. So I just weighed anchor, and now I'm peeking up the mainsail, and we're going to get sail. All right, so now we got to bring her about before we go aground on the Philosopher's Sandbar. Once we get over onto port tack, we should be able to lay the course out of here, out of Boca Grande Key, which is about 15 miles west of Key West. And now we're turning back the other way. We're headed toward Marathon.
Grande Key around 9 o'clock this morning, and we've had these southeast winds, which means we've been close hauled the entire day, but generally laying course. We passed Key West a few hours ago, and so we're working our way. Our destination is for today, though it's probably going to be late tonight, possibly early tomorrow morning, is Newfound Harbor. We got another front coming through with strong southwest-west winds developing tomorrow. So Newfound Harbor, according to the guide, is relatively well protected and has decent holding. So let's hope all that's true. So I'll stay there until that front goes through, and then when it comes around to the north, I plan to proceed back to Marathon. And so that's the plan. So we got southeasterly winds. They're supposed to back more east-southeast, which is bad for us. So we're going to probably be doing some tacking here. And then gradually veer back more south-south, south to southeast overnight. So we got her jammed up into the wind, which she doesn't like. But at least the seas are fairly flat here. So we're inside the Hawk Channel. So the sailing's not too bad. I would have had more favorable winds tomorrow, but as they're supposed to go south and south-southwest, which would have been beamed to broad reaching, much faster sailing. But as I say, they're predicting quite a pickup in the wind tomorrow afternoon, tomorrow night. And I would really rather get into Newfound Harbor tonight, even if it's late at night, early tomorrow morning, then have a chance to find a good, to assess my anchoring spot and make sure my anchor is in and all that before the heavy weather shows up. So we'll deal with being close-hauled. And it's pretty quiet out here, just a few boats. I see another sail over there. Today is Thursday, so it's still a weekday. And so we're going to be sailing into the evening here. We'll go grind up some more fresh coffee. And we'll see where we are tomorrow. Here we are in Newfound Harbor. Sailed in last night. Today is Ththursday, February 6, 2020. As you can see, it's quite an expansive bay. But there's a lot of shoal water around, and I would never have attempted to sail in here last night without the help of OpenCPN, because the channel leading in is not that wide. We got strong winds coming tonight with this frontal passage, and cruising guide says the bottom is sand, so should be good holding. Let's hope that's true. Believe it or not, just a few hours later, the winds calmed right down, and the winds are now northerly, even north-northwesterly. So I pulled up the anchor and sailing back out of Newfound Harbor, and then it's about 16, 17 miles to Marathon. It was a beam reach, cloudy day, and with the rough weather, there weren't too many boats. I was surprised there was any boats anchored out there, but there were still a couple boats anchored. That must have been fun last night, because this anchorage outside is exposed to the west, and so you got to watch your weather when you're anchored out here. But as long as the winds are easterly, it's a fairly comfortable anchorage. So I went and got a dinghy pass, the city marina, which allows me to land my dinghy, and also gives me a mailing address. And I need to replace my batteries. I've had those AGMs, Vmax AGMs, now for 6 years, and they still work, but they're definitely losing their capacity, and it's time for they're due for a replacement. So I'm going to replace my batteries with the same ones I purchased 6 years ago, which are the Vmax 125 amp hour AGM batteries, specifically designed for solar charging. As you can see, they're $289 a piece, and that does include shipping. I got it for slightly less because I bought a pack of two of them, which I got for $550. So I got them for $275 a piece, which is a pretty good deal. Now, one criticism I get, this is mainly from older sailors, when I talk about AGM batteries, is they come back and say, well, they're quite expensive.
whereas just good old-fashioned lead-acid batteries are a really good buy. Now, I've never had good luck with lead-acid batteries. The previous two batteries I had that were lead-acid didn't even last 2 years with solar charging. But anyway, let's take a look at a popular lead-acid battery, which are the Trojan. So this battery is 100 amp hour, 12 volt battery, and it's selling for $233, and then you got $39 shipping. So that's $272 for 100 amp hours, which works out to $272 an amp hour. Now recall that the AGM batteries we bought were $289 for 125 amp hours, which rounds up to about $232 an amp hour. So per amp hour, the AGM batteries are actually less expensive than the Trojan lead acid batteries. Now, the very latest hot battery that's on the market are lithium batteries. And so here's the Battleborn 100 amp hour lithium 12 volt battery. And they claim that these batteries last much longer than either flooded or AGM batteries. And you can discharge them all the way down to zero and charge them right back up without any trouble. And furthermore, if you read down, they only weigh 31 pounds, which is about a third the weight of an AGM or lead acid battery. So considerable savings in weight. But you're sure not saving any money. As you can see, these retail for $949, which does include shipping at least. But that's $949 per amp hour. Recall our AGMs were $232 an amp hour. So that's more than four times the number of dollars per amp hour of storage for lithium batteries than for AGMs. So if we're just looking at longevity, then to justify that cost, if the AGMs last 6 years, then the Battleborns would have to last at least 24 years because we could buy four sets of AGMs for the same price. And they say the lithium batteries have much better longevity, but 24 years, I've never known any battery that has lasted more than 20 years. So I'm going to stick with the AGMs. Roses are red, violets are blue. It's Valentine's Day 2020, and I have no new messages. How about you? But wait, there is a message. Excited, I scurry up the companionway and into the dinghy. The little motor responds with a roar. Two large boxes are there waiting for me. I get them back to the boat and have an argument with gravity trying to get them onto the boat. My trembling fingers cut the wrapping tape to reveal what's inside. Two brand new 125 amp hour AGM batteries, specifically for solar charging, from Amazon.com. With free shipping. I love you, Amazon.com. And I'm gonna keep on loving you. Cause it's the only thing I wanna do. I don't wanna sleep. Okay. So before we start changing batteries, let's just make sure we're not doing anything stupid here. I've disconnected all the solar panels. I just turned the fridge off. Radio is off. Inverter is off. So everything is off. Because I've done stupid battery tricks before. I remember one time I went to cut one of these wires, just cut it down to the appropriate length, and forgot that I still had
the other end of it attached to the battery. So when the metal wire cutter went through, suddenly it shorted out. And it got so hot that the plastic insulation on the wire started bubbling and there was black smoke coming out. And so you kind of remember those things, you know, when you almost set your boat on fire. And it reminds you that that's not something you want to do again.
Mm. Now, here's where the lighter lithium batteries would be quite the advantage, wouldn't they? Because it's often batteries are in awkward places and they're not light. So you just have to try to horse it out and be careful you don't damage anything in the process. Such as the refrigeration unit. There's one. You don't even want to contemplate what would happen to your foot if that strap broke, do you? Alright. We're going in for number two here. One. There's two. So all I'll do is I'm going to put a little bit of this dielectric grease on all the contacts here. Helps to protect and keep good electrical contacts. Now my 12 volt system grew organically, and originally I just had one battery. So effectively I've kept it that way. And what I've done is I just tied the positive terminals together and the negative terminals together. And these are both identical batteries. So we have two identical 125 amp hour batteries, but when you tie them together like this, you're just creating one 250 amp hour battery. So we got the rat's nest reattached here. And solar charge controller is showing 12.9 volts. That's good. And the forward charge controller is also showing 12.9 on the battery bank. So that's good. Let's try turning the fridge on here. All right, got a green light. So far, so good. Yeah. Try turning the radio on. All right, that looks pretty good.
Water's a light to moderate chop, becoming smooth to a light chop. Isolate.
Let's just see if the AIS comes through. We'll test the lights, and we'll do that tonight, see if the nav lights are... And while we're waiting for that, just click the inverter on here. Okay, the inverter seems to work. And yes, we have GPS coordinates on the radio. So far, so good. So now we got to reattach. Okay, so I just plugged the solar panels back in and the voltage went up. That's good. And we got 5.7 amps. That's the main set of panels. And see what we got on this guy, 3.6 amps. Good. So 3.5, 5.5. So we got about 9 amps going on the bank. And that's good.